الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه ومواله. Brothers and sisters in Islam, three announcements before we begin. Again, a humble reminder to those who may have not heard the announcements before, that in this masjid we're creating an atmosphere of two things, inshallah, in regards to the prayer. To remain seated before the prayer begins and to remain seated after the prayer ends. Why is that so? Because these are the most important times of the day. The time between the adhan and iqamah is the time for, could anyone tell me? Dua. Dua is accepted, supplication is accepted between the time of adhan and iqamah. So let us utilize that time in sitting and supplicating to Allah. And according to a hadith from the Prophet Muhammad ﷺ, so long we remain seated in our position without talking, moving, or breaking our wudu, the angels are praying for us while we are seated. It's a beautiful thing, mashallah. So if we don't have any obligations, we should make sure that we spend at least 4 to 5 minutes after the prayer to take in those du'as from the angels also. Number two, inshallah, second announcement. It was announced yesterday that, and also the day before, that subhanAllah, an apartment complex here in Dallas, which housed 28 families, which were refugees from Rohingya, burned down. And subhanAllah, they lost everything. So alhamdulillah, many of the masajid across the DFW area are working together to try to do what we can to help them with their lives. We are still collecting blankets and clothing or anything that's on the list that was emailed to you. Please, if you can, bring those items and put it in the far corner by the gymnasium, by the stairs. Make sure it's something that is usable, that is new, that is clean. May Allah bless all of us for helping our brothers and sisters and allow us to be there to support each other's back. Ameen, Rabbil Alameen. And final announcement, our dear Sheikh Al-Salam and his group, inshallah, are leaving for Umrah. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to take them safely. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to include us and our families and our community in their du'as. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept their presence in Medina Munawwara and Makkah Mukarramah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept their worship and ibadat and allow them to enrich themselves with spirituality and bring it back to our community and spread it amongst us, inshallah. Ameen, Ya Rabbil Alameen. Inshallah, today we're just going to cover five more points. If you recall, we are talking about grooming ourselves and how this is also a very important sunnah. And it's not something that we do for others. It is something that we do for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So again, we are not doing it for others. We're not doing it to show off ourselves so the brothers could be on the cover of GQ magazine. No, we're doing this because we're doing it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. In regards to the brothers, there are two more things left. To grow and lengthen the beard to a fifth pole. To trim any hair after that which exceeds a fifth pole. These are the teachings from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. We learn from the hadith of Amr ibn Shu'ayb radiallahu ta'ala, who reports from his father, who reported from Amr's grandfather radiallahu anhum ajma'in, who said that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would clip the width and the length of his beard. In another narration, the Prophet ﷺ said, differ from the idol worshippers, grow the beards abundantly and cut the mustaches short. This hadith is also in Bukhari, the first hadith is in Tirmidhi. The purpose wasn't solely distinction from others, but it's also a very important and great sunnah of all the Prophet ﷺ. So again, we talked about this a week ago or 2 weeks ago. Let us not learn the deen to point fingers at people who are not doing what we're learning to do. Rather, we point those fingers internally to say, this is for me, I need to do the best I can do for myself. For those of us who have a beard, this teaches us the importance of taking care of it to make sure that it is presentable and it looks good. Let us not be of such that we don't take care of the sunnah, that people would point their fingers to us and say, that is what this religion is about. We are not dirty people. Half of our deen is cleanliness. Half of our deen is purity. Muslims are supposed to be the cleanest people on this earth. It is time that we revive that sunnah in our communities, in our masajid, in our homes, everywhere we go. If we see something on the ground that doesn't belong on the ground, it is not befitting. It is not befitting for a Muslim to walk over it and walk on.
Because the lowest level of faith, the lowest, when your battery says 2%, that's like the lowest. What does that mean? That you see something on the ground and you pick it up. That's the lowest level of faith. Now, what to say if I see a wrapper of chips on the floor as I'm walking out of the masjid and I step over and I continue walking? What is it? What does it say about me when I walk into a bathroom and it's filthy, dirty, and I just walk on? So if we all do our part, inshallah, we can uphold cleanliness within our society. For cleanliness brings the angels and blessings with it. And lastly, for the men, before we begin the women, is to apply deodorant or some perfume. When the time of Jumu'ah began at the time of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there was one adhan. But the thing was that people were working. It's the middle of the day, it's hot. They're coming from labor jobs or from business and trade. They would be sweating and there would be some body odor. So the adhan was called first so that you can go home, clean up, and prepare yourself to come for Salatul Jum'ah. Because cleanliness is important for ourselves also. We learn from the hadith of Anas ibn Malik radiallahu ta'ala that the Prophet had perfume which he used to apply. This was a sunnah that he himself practiced. So let us make it a practice that in our homes or outside or in the masjid, we apply some deodorant or perfume. And when it comes to perfume, everyone, perfume which isn't strong. Remember, there's people around you that have sensitivities. Now, back in the days, they had the Jannatul Firdaus and Majmua, was it Majmua or something? Man, those things were strong. You know, if you stand beside someone, I would have a migraine after prayer because those are really strong perfumes. We cleanse ourselves, we bathe ourselves, and we put something light on, which would, inshallah, would emit a good scent from us, inshallah. As for the women, we move on now from the men to the women. There's three things we want to talk about. Number one, keep your hair longer than shoulder length. You know, it's so strange nowadays that we are living in a society where extensions are bought in large numbers. Wigs are being made and produced in large numbers. Wigs aren't cheap. For those who wear those wigs, you're talking about thousands of dollars. It's a lucrative business. Because some people, due to their genes or whatever else, their hair doesn't grow long. So they put extensions or they wear wigs. For those who Allah has blessed with the hair, it's a ni'mah. What is everyone? Ni'mah. Even for the sisters, it's a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So to allow their hair to grow, it's a blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and it's acknowledgement of His blessing. So you find in a hadith from Abdullah ibn Amr radiallahu ta'ala that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam forbade shoulder length hair for women who are free of slavery. It was common the women who were slaves at that time, they would cut their hair short because they never had the time to take care of their hair. But for those who didn't, they should allow their hair to grow. As it comes to perfume, it is more common that the women wear perfume and that too very strong when it's outside. Applying perfume is okay for the sisters so long they keep it indoors. Refrain from applying any when going outdoors. And that means of a scent that is distinct and people could smell it. Why? Because according to hadith of Abu Musa Ash'ari radiallahu ta'ala, he reports that the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, when a woman applies perfume and passes by a group of people so they can notice her scent, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, and this is the word of the hadith, she is like this and this. He expressed something very harsh that even the words of the hadith did not mention. When it comes to anklets, when it comes to heels, when it comes to scent, anything that can be a distraction or an attraction which can lure the gazes or minds of anyone towards that is something which our Islam does not promote or permit. They should wear perfume. They should buy the best of Chanel 5 if they can. Wear it at home. Wear it amongst your friends and family. Don't wear it and go out with it because it may, and it most likely will, give a wrong signal. And the last thing in regards to hair and perfume, because these are contemporary issues and topics, refrain from threading or plucking your eyebrows to shape them or make them thinner. According to hadith of Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu ta'ala, he expressed, may Allah curse the woman who applies tattoos on others or those who seek tattoos. and the women who pluck their eyebrows of other women, and those who get them plucked, and those who cleave their teeth for the sake of beauty. All of these women alter the creation of Allah. So it was a sign of beauty for the teeth to have a gap, and the women would literally do some work to make sure that gap was there. Or they would, and it's amazing how the fashion trends go. First it was thinning the eyebrows, then it was pencil eyebrows, and then it was removing the eyebrows and tattooing the eyebrows. Now the style is to have bushy eyebrows. Like, what just happened there? First he said small, 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 gone, and then back. It doesn't work like this. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, every sunnah, every practice, if he was harsh, my dear brothers and sisters, he wasn't harsh because sallallahu alaihi wasallam was jealous, na'udhu billah. He wasn't harsh because he was envious. He was harsh because he knows the harm this will bring to us. What harm does it bring to my body, my soul, my mind? I don't know. Technology and science and research is only as good as the time that it's done for. So if someone has to shape their eyebrows, so long they maintain the shape of the eyebrow, it's fine. But if they're thinning out the eyebrow, changing the shape of the eyebrow, removing the eyebrow and touching the eyebrow, the Prophet ﷺ said, may Allah curse that woman. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive all of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guide all of us. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala strengthen our resolve to understand the wisdom and the beauty behind the sunnah of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and to adopt them willingly, wholeheartedly, believing that there is goodness in it in our life and in the akhirah. Ameen ya Rabbil Alameen. May Allah bless all of you for your attendance and your time. And inshallah, we look forward to speaking to you all soon. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.